Welcome back to the Pursuit Podcast. We've got a special treat for you in June. From this month, we're going to be airing the podcast twice weekly. Instead of coming back next Tuesday, check in with us Thursday for a brand new episode. We're able to bring you two episodes a week thanks to our sponsors. We're being sponsored by Nexamo, who supplies APIs for voice, SMS, verification, and a ton of other really interesting developer tools all focused on communications. If you want to check out what they do, they're at nexamo.com. If you want to thank them for us, find them over on Twitter at @nexamodev. I'm your host, Jessica Rose. I'm here today with
Peter Aitken. I'm the organizer of Scotland JS and Scotland CSS, two front-end tech conferences in Scotland. I also founded Global Diversity CFP Day, and I work at Litmus.
This sounds like a lot of stuff to do.
Well, it keeps me busy, shall we say.
So today we're going to chat a bit about the conferences, but we're also going to take a look at the Global CFP Day you ran.
Sure.
Cool. So let's chat about Scotland JS, Scotland CSS. I imagine they're in Scotland.
They are. They're both hosted in Edinburgh, and they are right next to each other in terms of time. Scotland CSS is going to be on the 18th of July, about 6 weeks away, and Scotland JS is going to be on the Thursday, the 19th, and Friday, the 20th of July, both in Edinburgh.
So if I wanted to run my own conference, maybe not two conferences back to back immediately, but say I really want to run my own conference, maybe I want to run it in Edinburgh because it's just a lovely city, where on earth would I get started? How did you get started?
How did I get started? Let's see, I think how I got started would probably be slightly different to how other folks would get started.
Oh.
It was very much a case of accidental organizer. Scotland JS originally started off as a sort of company's event that was put on for the community. So I used to work for a company called Cultivate.
Ah.
And way back when Scotland JS first started, it was Mark Connell's idea to put this on. And during, well, he had some downtime at one point and put together a snazzy web app of Edinburgh Castle. And pretty much the colours would change in time with a weather API and a time of day API. And yeah, it was all quite swish. And it was pretty much just a sign-up app. Maybe about 6 months later, I joined the company. Maybe another 6 months after that, the director, Paul, said, you know, we should really do something about this. And we were always kind of looking to, expecting Mark to sort of pick up and run with us since it was his idea. And nothing really happened. And then another couple of months passed and Paul said again, you know, this would be really good for the community, you know, if we organize this.
It sounds like you got very much nudged into it. Be like, well, maybe.
Pretty much. So I had a quiet chat with Martin. Said, we're kind of, this is everybody else's expectation or what we're thinking. This is your baby and you're going to run with it. And he said, I feel it's really important, but I just can't be bothered effectively.
And you'd be like, I think this is really important for you to do.
No, it wasn't even that. It was just I started picking away at the things on the Trello board, like finding a venue and all that sort of stuff. And here we are, like 6 years later. So, but 3 years ago, with pretty much the events are now, well, they always were a non-profit, but they're now pretty much looked after by myself and not the company. So it's, I've graduated and then we grew with Scotland CSS and the CFP Day was just something else entirely. So, yeah.
So for our dear listener who might be very, very far away from Scotland, uh-huh, or might be near enough to get there but hasn't heard of it yet, Scotland JS and Scotland CSS are both one-day conferences?
No, Scotland CSS is a one-day conference. Scotland JS is a two-day conference. Usually we have a workshop associated with each event as well.
So, okay, you got gently nudged into this, but if I was going to start my own conference, maybe not a competing conference, I'm not going to start like Birmingham JS and Birmingham CSS on the same days. But if I or our dear listener wanted to start, what would you suggest? You say, well, if you really want to run a conference, look out for these things or do this first, or this is going to be harder than you expect.
Oh, yeah. I suppose the first thing you need to work out is what is the kind of event you want to run and is it going to be financially viable? To find out if you're going to have enough people that are interested, you know, I would suggest having some sort of sign-up page explaining what you're intending doing and will folk be willing to, if it was at this time of the year, in this sort of location, and this is what it was going to be about, and this is how much it would cost you, would you be willing to attend? or would you happily buy a ticket sort of thing? And then you can gauge based on that, you know, how much can we afford for a venue? Are there even enough people to make this viable?
So yeah, I think the money might be something folks who are like, I'm going to run a conference.
Yeah.
Just as a ballpark, how much money could running a conference cost?
It depends on scale. You know, our friend Kim Creighton has currently started Cause a Scene Conf, which is a traveling conference. And I believe there's very little investment there. They're very small. So I think if you could get hold of a space that holds 30, 50 people, sponsored by a local company, then, you know, that would be awesome if it's going to be a reasonably small event. As things grow, you're obviously going to want more room, and finding bigger spaces gets a bit more tricky. But, you know, how big is it going to be? Is it going to be 100, 200, 300, 500, 1,000 people that are going to be interested?
So that's a good question as well. Like, if I sell, or if I sell and give away 100 tickets, I'm probably not going to have 100 people show up, am I?
Ooh, that's an interesting one. I've had completely different results with that, you know, in terms of people not showing on the day. Sometimes there's maybe about 10, 15 folks that don't make it along. Maybe there's been like work emergencies, family emergencies. I don't actually know. And some years it's like everybody's pretty much there at opening. And there's no way to gauge it. Yeah, it's interesting.
I was going to say, oh, maybe should people be padding out some extra tickets? But in your case, oh my, no.
Oh no. it's similar in that we originally put on t-shirts for everybody. And there's a whole discussion about t-shirts to be had and sizes and fits and cuts and all these sorts of things to make sure there are enough for everybody. However, when we did some feedback or asked for some feedback around that, pretty much a third of the attendees were interested in the t-shirts. Another third were happy to have it, but, you know, we'd use it for dusting about the house.
Yeah.
And another third weren't bothered at all. So really a third of people being engaged with that as a sort of benefit. They decided, you know, it's not worth the effort and the expense that's involved there.
Because these are all things you have to do for your conference. You've got to get a venue. Mm-hmm. If you're in a position where people are going to expect some kind of swag bags, you've got to go and have stuff made and get them. You've got to feed people.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So yeah.
The list goes on. You know, it's, do you need a caterer, or does your venue provide or mandate that you use a particular caterer?
That's the thing a lot of new organizers don't notice, is oftentimes your venue is not going to give you a lot of options around food.
Yeah, yeah. And at the same time, you've got to be mindful of the dietary requirements of your volunteers or staff or team, your speakers, your attendees. And at the same time, do they have any access needs around the venue? There's a whole wealth of questions to be asked at all points. That
I've heard another organizer describe it as running a series of talks and a wedding at the same time.
I know of someone who ran a conference and then within a week it was their wedding.
Yeah.
That seems like a lot of everything. Well, I guess they could just use the same caterers, right?
I don't even know if they were in the same country, Maya has, but yeah, it just astonishes me, yeah.
I'm really interested in having a chat about the Global Diversity CFP Day,
sure.
Because it sounds very much like, could you first tell us a little bit about it? But it sounds very much like this project came out of your work with Scotland JS and Scotland CSS.
Oh, it did, it did. Remind me to come back to how it came about then. So Global Diversity CFP Day is allowing people around the world to sign up and put on a workshop wherever they are and provide them with the tools and educational material to enable them to do that easily, leaving them to find a venue, put together a team, like a facilitator to run the day, and a group of mentors who are positive, enthusiastic and encouraging.
So you built the framework to allow people to run their own events, to allow them to help, not make, but facilitate new speakers?
Yep.
This sounds like a very, very complex, very interesting structure.
It was, I suppose if we wind back to where this came from, it was kind of one of these things that was, I started using a system called Paper Call for the conferences and clicked the checkbox to say anonymize applicants. And, you know, previously we had our own home-baked CFP system. I could see the applications as they come in. And you still can with Paper Call, but you can't see who they're coming from.
And for our listener who might not be familiar, CFP?
Oh, good point. This is something we need to make clearer on the website as well. CFP stands for Call for Proposals. Conferences who don't invite all of their speakers and choose all of those speakers themselves will open up a call for proposals process. And what that effectively does is they invite everyone and anyone to apply to speak, and they will then, through whatever their criteria is, decide on from those applicants who's going to be invited to participate and speak.
Okay, so you were getting proposals in. You were getting people saying, hi, I want to speak at your conference. Here's my idea.
Yes.
And these were coming in anonymized.
Through paper call, yeah. So on paper call, what happens is, if Jess wants to speak at a conference, Jess can sign up, add their talk, and then submit that proposal to as many conferences that are registered on paper call.
And if our dear listener hasn't done any conference speaking before, mm-hmm. what would I submit?
That's a very popular question. So if you go to the Global Diversity CFP site, there's the schedule page, which has all of the educational material and advice videos. The first video with Raquel Velez and Sarah May, they discuss what would make a good proposal and what are things to avoid. Yeah, there's lots of really good advice in there.
Are these videos still available somewhere?
Yep, if you go up on globaldiversitycfpday.com/schedule, you should be able to see them all there.
Very exciting.
Mm. So to wind back a little bit, prior to 2016, I'd always sort of hosted a hangout session and promoted this publicly on the Twitters, saying, you know, if you would like to speak or apply to speak at the conferences and have any questions or any queries, here's this sort of hangout that we're hosting. And I would get a few of the previous speakers who'd been through the process before involved as well to help answer any questions, or if people coming along had any questions for me as the organizer. But the interesting thing was I never really knew as to how valuable these sessions were to people. So I would host usually two or three of these before each event. And it wasn't until the end of the 2015 event when Katie Fenn sort of spoke to me after the conference and said, that was amazing, that hangout was just the thing that I needed. In effect, my sort of perception is that having done it myself, you know, it's like you'll see on the Twitters, there'll be a CFP will open for an event. You're meaning to get that first proposal together.
Mm, this feels very familiar.
Yeah, time ticks away and then it closes and you're like, oh no. And Katie said that having the hangout session was the thing that nudged her into action. And in 2016, I was a bit slow about organizing those. And I kind of woke up one morning and I had this idea. Why don't we have a couple of workshops, in-person workshops, specifically for people from underrepresented and marginalized groups? And if this event, this workshop is for them, there'll be nobody else well actually-ing them or talking over them. Everybody will be treated respectfully. The clue, you know, being a diversity CFP workshop was in the name. And that kind of, oh, so we, what was this? This was 4 weeks before the CFP closed. And I kind of put a line in the sand, like a date for all of these workshops to be in the same day, which would be in 3 weeks' time. And so I chatted to one of our sponsors who has an office in terms of trying to get a venue for these. So one of our sponsors has a venue in Glasgow and Edinburgh, and they were very happy to provide that. I got chatting with my previous boss in Dublin, who thought this was a great idea. Can we host one in Dublin? And all of a sudden, cool. We were in two countries.
Sort of reverse bullying someone to do the you didn't have to nudge, yeah. You just had to wait. And they nudged you to get to do it.
Kind of. So I got chatting to Katie Fenn as well, having, you know, Katie, you know, was very pleased with the hangout. And Katie it was Sheffield Katie hosted one in. And I thought, there's quite a lot of people in London. Wouldn't it be good if we had one in London? And Melinda at Future Learn very kindly hosted our workshop in London. And
For folks who might not know, that's one of my coworkers.
Yes, indeed. Then I sort of pinged the folks in Berlin, from Berlin GS, and they were more than happy to put this on as well. So these, all of a sudden we had six workshops across four countries, and it kind of felt like an idea that would ever kind of work in my head. Given how it's grown, I still kind of don't believe that it's all kind of happened. But yeah, everybody kept saying yes. And so the thing being, you know, it's that we've got six different events and we want a consistent set of material for everybody to be able to run some scary event in 3 weeks' time. And so that's how I got chatting to Raquel Velez and Sarah May, and they put together the advice video that you can still see on Global Diversity CFP Day. So given that these workshops had a massive impact on the diversity of the applicants to our CFP, and then the resulting speaking lineup, and thereby our attendees as well, you know, every couple of months, people from different parts of the world were getting in touch saying, well, how did you manage to achieve this lineup, given that your ticket holders have an anonymized round of voting, a single round of voting for your speakers? You know, it's like statistically, there is no way that we should have achieved a sort of 50-50 gender split, which has happened again, which is incredible. So my thinking was, how can we take what we've done for the people from underrepresented and marginalized groups in our local sort of community and in the sort of pockets between Dublin and London and Berlin? How can we take this and make it available to all tech communities worldwide? Because there was nothing specific in the advice that we were given. But, you know, and it was to be able to make it easy for lots of random people on the internet, like all over the world, to sign up to run these things. And it resulted that we had, was it 52 cities and one online, which was incredible. And just last Friday, there was a workshop run in Albania as well, using the same material, which is awesome.
How did this impact, well, I guess you'd have the most measurable evidence for how this impacted folks submitting to Scotland JS or Scotland CSS. But what have you heard back from attendees on how that impacted their ability to sort of get out onto stages?
I've not got too much in the way of feedback, it has to be said. I think I can see things like We Rise conference in Atlanta has five speakers that came through CFPD, which is awesome.
So you've got to do a little bit of light, non-creepy stalking to sort of see your results in the wild.
Well, there's no, not at all. It's
not stalking.
No, the events usually, well, in particular, that was We Rise is run by Women Who Code Atlanta, and Women Who Code Atlanta were also heavily involved in CFP Day in Atlanta. So we CFP Day Twitter account always gets a mention anytime there's somebody who's come through that process, which helps give us a little bit of visibility. And usually when somebody's come through that, they're keen to sort of say thanks for the support and encouragement and advice and all that kind of thing. So yeah, I know of a number of people that have come through that. But in terms of how it's impacted the applicants for Scotland CSS and Scotland JS, massively is the only way that I can sort of state it. I've got some stats in front of me. So let's see. I need to check which one belongs to which. So if we start with Scotland CSS, which has only had one edition so far in 2018, it received, from its first edition, 45 proposals. Eight of those were from people from underrepresented and marginalised groups. So that's about 17% in 2016, having run the diversity CFP workshops specifically for that event. In 2018, the number of proposals increased by 95% to 85. And the number of people from underrepresented groups went from 8 to 39. Which is a bit of a jump. So we went from having 17% of our applicants to 45. The more eye-opening sort of stats, sorry for all the numbers.
No, they're great numbers.
For Scotland GS, the number of proposals we usually get is usually increases by about 30 or 40 each year. And 2018 is our sixth edition. So if we go back to 2016, we got 190 proposals. About 32 of those proposals were for people from underrepresented and marginalised groups, about 17% of the total number. In 2018, the number of proposals jumped from 190 to 370, which is a 90% increase, which, wow.
This is definitely something that folks thinking about running their own conference for the first time might not have thought about. Like, to get your speakers, you're going to have to go through a lot. Well, if you've done a good job with outreach, you're going to have to do a lot of work to filter these.
Yeah, there's like a couple of days involved. But I've got one little last stat there before we go.
Please.
Before we leave the stats alone. So the number of proposals in 2018 went from 190 to 370. The number of proposals from underrepresented and marginalised groups went from 32 to 120. We went from 17% of our applicants to a third, which is tremendous.
How unreasonably proud of yourself are you? How entirely reasonably proud of yourself are you?
I'm very pleased with that.
and I've absolutely got to ask, because we're recording remotely, you're not right here with me. You've got a cheat sheet, don't you? Like, you haven't memorized all these.
I've got these two big sets of stats in front of me.
Oh, good. I was really impressed, though. You were like, this percent of this. I was like, oh, is he doing the math on the fly?
Oh, God, no. But no, it's everything we've been doing, particularly over since about 2015, you know, I would say very much my knowledge around diversity and inclusion was somewhat ignorant. And if anything, in 2015, it started paying a bit of lip service, is the best way I could describe it. And Lena Reinhart very kindly gave a keynote talk, which pretty much opened up my eyes to the whole subject and how people are treated or mistreated within our field and society. And I was basically, I'm not a fan of writing up blog posts or talking about lots of things. So our workshops were more the action that demonstrate Peter cares about this, and this is the effort that we're making. And then in 2018, we've seen this massive, massive spike. And yeah, this is because we've turned it into a global event, but it's not even specifically for Scotland, GS and CSS anymore. It's for all people to basically provide a safe and positive, encouraging place or places for people from underrepresented and marginalised groups to apply to speak at whatever their tech niche is, whatever area it is. So it's opened it up to everyone. So
that sounds like a fantastic mission statement.
So if any organisers are struggling to attract people from these groups, then they should be running a workshop.
Fantastic. So on the Pursuit podcast, we try and make sure that if our listener has been really, really taken by something we've said, that we've give them a little bit of advice or enough detail for them to dig deeper and learn some more.
Okay.
And if I'm a potential speaker, or if our dear listener, or if someone out there in the wilds of the internet really wants to get on stage and start speaking, aside from going to your website, which one more time was?
GlobalDiversityCFPD.com.
Cool. Aside from going to that and getting some great advice, what kind of like quick pocket advice could you offer them or offer me?
I think I'm more looking for advice from yourself, Jess. Practice is the main thing. You know, it's like first time is always going to be a bag of nerves for most folks. And just the more we can get out and practice, and you're always your own worst critic. Don't let it put you off. Get feedback from people, improve your talk, and talk about something that you're passionate about or something that really, really hacks you off, because that sort of emotion will come across when you're speaking. Yeah.
So I always like to warn people. I always used to like to warn people that nobody likes their first conference talk.
Yeah.
But I work with a woman who's absolutely brilliant, who did her first conference talk and nailed it and just got off stage. I was like, oh, it was great. So I had to revise my advice. Almost everyone hates their first conference talk. But what if we're talking to someone who, like you, sees a problem in their immediate vicinity and wants to not just work to address that, but wants to work to address that on a wider scale? What if somebody doesn't want to do a global diversity CFP day, but they want to change the number of people from working class backgrounds that have the chance to experiment with AV technologies? What if they want to make sure that young people are getting to experience blockchain and not just crypto hype? What kinds of advice would you give to somebody who wants to address, like you did, a larger problem in their ecosystem? What kinds of structures could they look at? How did you get started?
It was all completely accidental.
So your advice is be lucky.
No, I think that I suppose there's the area of technology or the area of interest that you have, and then there's the group of people that from what you've been mentioning there, you know, and you need to be engaged with both of those things and be trying to bring them together in some means. Presumably you'd be actively engaged with people of a certain background that you're trying to attract. On social media, you would be able to better understand the things that are struggles for them. And how you can make it easy for them to participate in whatever it is that you're trying to promote and bring them together on.
This sounds like sound and solid advice. So just one more time, so we've said it a million times, where can people find your information on the Global Diversity CFP Day?
Yep, it's on the site, globaldiversitycfpd.com/schedule. That's where you'll find all the videos. And I believe there's one right at the one at the bottom is from yourself, Jess. Thank you very much for that.
Yes, I did a video as well, which I can't for the life of me remember what it's about. There's lots of stuttering in it, though.
No, not at all. Not at all. The advice was all about giving people an idea of what will happen on the day of their talk.
Oh.
You know, leading up to and sort of getting an idea for the venue. Is there anyone you need to check in with? Testing your laptop and all these kind of things.
I'm going to run all of the things I make past you so you can just remind me about it. You'd be like, oh, Podcast 31, that's when you had somebody come on and talk about it. It'll be fine. And if somebody wanted to go ahead and make sure they've cleared dates in their diary, when is Scotland JS and Scotland CSS again?
18th through 20th of July, 2018.
And if I want to follow you online or argue with you on the internet, where can I find you?
My Twitter handle is Jiggy, J-I-G-G-Y underscore Pete, P-E-T-E.
But you don't like being called Pete.
No.
Ah, no. Always Peter, never Pete, unless you're on Twitter.
Yeah, pretty much.
Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you very much for having me, Jess. Cheers.
Thanks so much for listening. If any of you do get a chance to get to the Scotland CSS conference, I'm going to be emceeing. Come say hello. Even if you can't make it all the way to Scotland, please do join us again on Thursday for a brand new episode. We're going to be joined by Coraline Ada and Naomi Freeman talking about the value of empathy in technology.